On this wild and wonderful Wednesday edition of Locked On Grizzlies, the dynamic duo rides again. DeMichael Cole and I talk Zach Edey and the Memphis Grizzlies, perhaps in cahoots, chatting it up. We'll talk NBA combine takeaways, anything that surprised us so far there in Chicago, and then Bronny James, who's going to make LeBron eat his words? Can Memphis steal away a couple of Jameses? We'll talk about that and more on this episode of Locked On Grizzlies. Let's lock in.
You are Locked On Grizzlies, your daily Memphis Grizzlies podcast, part of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team every day.
We are indeed your team each and every day, and we are happy to be here with you on Locked On Grizzlies. It is I, Joe Mullinax, joined by my co-host, DeMichael Cole, and once again, you are locked in with us here on Locked On Grizzlies. This episode of Locked On Grizzlies is brought to you by Game Time. A big fan of Game Time, and you should be as well. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use the code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off your first purchase. Terms apply. Again, we are free and available wherever you get podcasts. As proud members of the Locked On Podcast Network, your team each and every single day. Like, comment, rate, review, subscribe. We've had a couple of really good days over on YouTube. Shout out to everybody in the comments. Even if you call me Joe Mullisuck, or even if you say I don't know anything about basketball, keep watching, keep listening, keep interacting with us. It's been a really good – yeah, Mullisuck's pretty good. I can't really hate on that too much. But, you know, we've gotten good feedback. Any feedback is fine. Continue to make us a part of your everyday NBA and Memphis Grizzlies content consumption. A partner, it was a busy day for you yesterday, chasing down leads about assistant coaches and that sort of thing. But I, you know, you weren't able to kind of talk about that yesterday. Forgive me for assuming, partner. You know what they say about assuming. Yeah. I feel like we might run the risk of overvaluing that news, if that makes sense, if we continue to discuss it. I feel like there was kind of a movement on social media to make it seem like it was a revolution of offensive basketball in Memphis. And that's not going to happen, right? You don't go from being a player's personal coach, basically, to an offensive coordinator. There's probably steps that go along there. So no offense to LaRoche. We'll talk more about him. I felt like coming out of the combine, it made sense today to focus on actual combine things involving the NBA draft. And then maybe tomorrow, if it's okay, there was a major story that came out of The Athletic saying that, and I think it was also Zach Lowe and ESPN as well, you know, how the Grizzlies plan on using that number 9 pick. Maybe that's a good topic for our Thursday show. Today I wanted to keep it draft-centric because Zach Edey, you know, I ended yesterday's show standing on the table for Donovan Clingan, tired of the slander. I don't know if you're able to hear it or not.
Yeah, partner, I did.
But I got a little bit fired up.
That's your guy.
And he's my guy, but Zach Edey's kind of making it sound like he might be Memphis's guy, right? And Drew Hill of the Daily Memphian, I believe, is the person we want to give credit for this story. The idea of Zach Edey saying, "Oh yeah, I've talked to Memphis. They've had their eye on me for a while." In the story, Drew points out that there's lots of smoke and mirrors this time of year and that sort of thing. And that is important to keep perspective on. Sometimes teams don't even talk to the players that they're actually going to draft. But I found it interesting that here is arguably the most dominant college basketball player of the last two seasons. Checks a major box for the Memphis Grizzlies. Almost certainly will be on the board at 9 overall. And if the Grizzlies were to trade back, partner, I think they would be able to find a Zach Edey in the late teens, early 20s. So what do you make of that comment from Edey that the Grizzlies and he have kind of had their eyes on one another over the last several weeks?
I don't make too much of it, you know, at this point, simply from the standpoint of, I mean, the Grizzlies are just doing their homework. They're going to talk to a bunch of guys, and he's a big man. I think no big man, no stone goes unturned. No big man will go unturned.
They should literally be watching every single big in this draft.
Every single one. And how could you not watch the best one from college basketball production-wise? You know, we can talk about production for versus potential all day. But production-wise, there's no conversation on who the best center has been the last 2 years in college basketball. But here's the interesting part to me, Joe. This is where the Zach Edey thing gets interesting, because The only problem that I really have when we talk about Zach Edey, Memphis, and all that is where you're going to select him. You know, the Grizzlies have the 9th pick right now. That feels like a reach, in my opinion. The Grizzlies don't pick again until 39. He's not going to be there at 39, in my opinion. So there's this big gap there where we've seen he's getting lottery buzz, late lottery, mid-first round, late first round. I've seen him in the 20s in some mocks. I've seen him as high as 15, 14. So with all that being said, you know, you got this wide range for this guy, but none of it is within the Grizzlies' current range. So some things got to get moved around or whatever the case may be. But here's what I think right now. I think the fact that when you take all of that out of the equation from a fit standpoint, he fits. He fits to me. I mean,
about this, he's moving better in Chicago than a lot of people thought he would.
He's moving better than last year. You remember last year he was in Chicago as well. He tested the waters last year, and he's even improved upon those numbers. So, I mean, take that, people that say he's already close to his ceiling. You know, from his junior year to his senior year, he's shown some improvements in lateral agility and things like that. Now, of course, no matter how he does in this stuff, there are going to be questions about how he plays in spacing and whatnot. But the thing about the Grizzly center spot is it's not a position where they're going to require you to really do too much. They need someone who's going to protect the rim. And I don't think there's anyone in the world who believes Zach Edey, you know, will have any problems protecting the rim in the NBA. He's going to be able to do that. Wherever he plays, he's going to be able to protect the rim. And again, he's a player who can allow Jaren to freestyle around. And one other thing that I like about the idea of adding him is when you go into those pick and rolls with Ja Morant and stuff like that, you can't really switch it. You switch anything against Zach Edey, it's going to be 2 points. So I like the idea of what he can bring in terms of adding some different things at the center spot that, you know, maybe Jonas Valanciunas had a little bit more than Steven Adams. I remember in that Golden State series, Golden State was switching against Steven Adams, and I just kept saying, like, man, he's got, you know, Andrew Wiggins on him, or he's got, you know, Jordan Poole on him, and they're not taking advantage of it enough when they switch. Zach Edey won't have that type of problem. Now, there are a bunch of great things that Steven Adams do that Zach Edey probably won't be great at least in the beginning. But all things said, I understand why there's chatter here. It's deservingly chatter. I don't know how they'll get him. Maybe you can add to that, Joe. But the fact that they're talking just kind of confirms what we want to believe, which is the Grizzlies are going to do their due diligence and talk to these bigs throughout this draft process.
And the reports of them exploring trades for the number 9 overall or with the number 9 overall pick, I think that's evidence of that. And again, we'll talk more about that on tomorrow's show. Today, the idea of them taking best player available, right? And again, if Donovan Klingon's there at 9, I think it's Donovan Klingon. But I yelled about that yesterday. Say they think it's Ron Holland, right? And Ron Holland falls to 9. If Holland is there, they take Holland, and then they trade up to 22 or 23 to take Zach Edey. That's a massively successful draft. I think they check numerous boxes there, and they are a better team than they were going into the process. That's a way that they can do it because they still have all of their own first round picks and they have two second rounders. It's hard for me to believe that if they were to pair Zaire Williams with, you know, number 39 in this draft and a future first, that doesn't get them into the early 20s, especially with a team that has numerous picks in this draft. So that would be enticing to me. And I think it gives them the possibility. Say Klingon gets picked early. Maybe they
let me add this too, Joe. Because
I mean, he did dominate Klingon in the championship game.
He did. Let's add this to what you just said. You just brought up an interesting possibility that I don't think we've talked about that much, which is acquiring another first round pick. Let's throw this out there too. You acquire another first round pick, that's another guaranteed contract that has to go on your roster. Right now, the Grizzlies are at 13, so that would be 15. Which would take them at least. Now you mentioned trading Zaire Williams as well, so I want to give you that would create a roster spot in theory, but I mean, would a team take him in there? I think the second round pick in a future first probably gets it done, protected first, you know, protect lottery protected or whatever the case may be, probably gets it done. But I'm with you, like I agree with your idea, but from the Grizzlies' standpoint, I think that's a question to ask: is are they willing to add 2 young guaranteed contracts where they really don't know what they're going to do with some of these guys on the back end of the roster yet.
Well, and the fascinating thing is, say they take Dalton Kanect and Zach Edey. Yeah, those guys are rookies. Yeah, they're young, but they're older rookies.
They can play now.
And they can play now. And you see Derek Lively and what he's doing for the Mavericks and other things like that. I think there's layers to this, right? So shout out to Zach Edey, who seems to be building. His agent is doing really good work.
Another Canadian, too. Bring the Canadians back to Memphis, right?
And in fairness, you pointed it out, you know, the folks that say that Edey doesn't have a ceiling, he literally improved from last year. So there is some level of possibility there for getting better. That is important to point out. Let us know if you agree with the idea of targeting Edey, not at 9. That feels really high to me. If 9 is high for Klingon, it most certainly is high for Edey. But at the same time, you know, late lottery.
Some people don't care, man.
I tell you what.
Some people will just want them bad.
Draft Twitter is on one at the moment. There's no denying about that from a variety of angles. But I digress. When we come back here on Locked On Grizzlies, we're going to talk about some other takeaways from the combine, some guys that have impressed, some guys that maybe are shooting a little bit better than you expected, shooting exactly how you expected, some overall combine thoughts. We'll talk about that next here on Locked On Grizzlies. But first, this episode of Locked On Grizzlies is brought to you by BetterHelp. Big fan of BetterHelp, and you should be as well. We all carry around different stressors. That's really important to understand, right? Different things can trigger us. And when we keep them bottled up, it really can affect us negatively, whether it is big or small. There is a safe space to get things off your chest, and it's therapy, figuring out how to work through whatever is weighing you down. It's a way of learning positive coping skills, a way to set boundaries, and it empowers you to be the best version of yourself. It isn't just for people that have experienced a major trauma. It could be folks that are looking for ways to get through each and every individual day. If you're thinking of starting therapy, give BetterHelp a try. Entirely online, designed to be convenient, flexible, and suited to your schedule. Get it off of your chest with BetterHelp. Visit BetterHelp.com/LockedOnNBA today and get 10% off your first month. That's BetterHelp, HELP.com/LockedOnNBA to get started. Check them out today. When we come back here on Locked On Grizzlies, we are talking NBA Combine takeaways. Stick with us. Welcome back to Locked On Grizzlies. I am Joe Mullinax, joined by my co-host, Michael Cole, the Commercial Appeal award-winning writer for the Commercial Appeal there in Memphis, Tennessee, Memphis Grizzlies beat writer, that is. I have been covering the Grizzlies for over a decade in a variety of spots, perhaps most notably over at Grizzly Bear Blues for several years as the site manager when it was part of the SB Nation umbrella. You've come to the right place is the bottom line. We've gotten some compliments, partner, about this being the best place for Grizzlies analysis, and I really appreciate that in the YouTube comments. You know, I know that made me blush. You know, that's DeMichael. DeMichael leads the charge in terms of a lot of that stuff, but I think we work well together and we continue to grow Locked On Grizzlies. So thanks to everybody, whether you like us, dislike us, usually it's disliking me, but whatever the case might be, thank you for the feedback and thank you for checking out Locked On Grizzlies. Checking out the NBA Combine, partner, following on X, social media, looking at the various numbers that you can look up online, but they're not wrong. Right. I thought that was funny. There is a major glitch in the system. And
almost,
you know,
tanked Stephon Castle's.
Stephon Castle apparently shrunk 2 or 3 inches. That's a concern for his health. Obviously, that was incorrect. And Castle was about what they expected him to be. Looking at the various tests and all those sorts of things.
Yeah.
It's important to point out again, I'm a football coach, so I make comparisons to football. I did that with LaRoche yesterday. I'll do it again here. Watching tape is still the best way to evaluate guys, right?
These
athletic tests do show you in theory what their ceiling could be, what if they added certain types of skills. But you watch film of guys and you get a feel for how they apply that within the game of basketball itself. Mm-hmm. And even though guys might look good in scrimmages like Bronny James did, we'll talk about him at the end of the show. It's more so about the actual reps in actual games. Agreed. But what were some things that surprised you or interested you coming out of the NBA Combine?
Yeah, I'm going to have some fun with this segment, Joe.
Please,
Shout out to the short arm guys out there. Let's point out, because the Grizzlies, it's not just Desmond Bain. We can give Desmond Bain some flack for, you know, having a short wingspan and things like that. But what about Dylan Brooks? Remember, he had a short wingspan for his size. And I know the old regime, quote-unquote, drafted Dylan Brooks. But this regime re-signed him. gave him a contract extension. So they valued him despite of his, you know, mediocre wingspan as well. And a couple guys that we've kind of linked to the Grizzlies recently, whether it be Reed Shepard and Kyle Filipowski, do not have really good wingspans. You know, I don't remember Kyle Filipowski's off the top of my head. Maybe you can figure that one out. But Reed Shepard, I think he was listed at 6'1 in height and had a 6'3 wingspan. I know Kyle Filipowski is 6'11. And I remember seeing like Khalil Ware's a wingspan being 7'4, somewhere in that range. You know, Zach Edey, of course, and 17, his wingspan. Donovan Klingon in the 7'6 range as well. And then there was Kyle Filipowski. So, you know, we talk about this idea of the Grizzlies possibly. I mean, if the other bigs are gone, and I mean, he's a guy who potentially could rise in this process. Like, you talk about guys who have the potential of rising through the draft process, he is, because offensively it's all there for him. But I don't know if the defensive concerns are going to go away when we find out that his wingspan isn't much bigger than his height. The short arm guys, some teams may overlook them, but the Grizzlies might not be one. So that stood out to me, especially Reed Shepard, you know, 6'1", 6'3", wingspan. He still gets his hands, you know, on a lot of balls with deflections and things like that. But I just wonder how NBA teams are going to view it, because the point is, you know, more so with Reed Shepard than, Kyle Filipowski. But if teams do the most and they get over analytical and all that, I'm sure there's going to be a team right there at number 9 that'll say, come on, Reed Shepard, and open their arms just wide. Bring you and your short arms over here.
Bring your Kirk Heinrich-looking tail over here, Reed Shepard. No, I think that, again, we've talked about in the past, there has to be another move for me if they do that. But yeah. I would understand the logic, especially if he tumbles that far.
He can shoot the ball.
That's good value at 9.
I'm 52% from 3-point range?
Yeah, unless you're the Oakland Grizzlies, right? In which case he shrinks up and shrivels up like some raisins. I'm going to go a little bit deeper cut here, partner. I hope you'll forgive me. Looking at different types of bigs, right? We talked about Zach Edey. Guys like Ware from Indiana, a physical freak. So much of what he did was impressive athletically. Again, you're talking about high ceilings. That's a guy that a lot of folks on X and Grizzlies Twitter have posted about, saying they like him as their top big prospect. You know, it's more than just athleticism. You have to be developed. You have to have basketball skill. But, you know, Ware checks that box if that's something that you're looking for from a big. And then I made fun of this a few episodes ago. But Jonathan Mogbo of San Francisco, you do research, right? And I still think saying he's top 15 is kind of crazy. But he looked good in his combine scrimmage, partner. He kind of gives off Kyle Anderson vibes in a way. He's one of those basketball players that does a lot of things well. He just can't really shoot it. So obviously the Grizzlies need shooting basketball players, and that's important. Yeah. But again, I feel like I made fun of Mogbo. I certainly wouldn't take him in the lottery. Yeah. But second round pick, if Memphis is sitting there at 39 and that guy's still on the board.
And let me point out to the listeners, when Joe Mullinax starts talking his draft stuff, you could, when he says he's tuned in, he's watching these guys and all that, you better listen. You go look at all the shows from last summer. I barely heard about this Brandon Podzimski guy.
And there was one person
that kept saying Brandon Podzimski for the Grizzlies, Brandon Podzimski. And that dude is going to make an all rookie team for Golden State this season. So when Joe Mullinax talks this stuff now, I'm tuned in, and you should be too.
And again, I want to credit Adam Pike, who's been high on Mogbo and Matt Hardlicka. Again, I think they're too high on the guy, but they have been on him. I like him as a high second round pick. That makes a lot of sense to me. And again, Kyle Anderson, I think, went 30th overall when he was drafted. So if you take him at the end of the first round, I'm not going to, you know, get super mad about that. But I really like those two. If you're not into Edey and Klingon, or if they're off the board for whatever reason, I still think Memphis needs a big. Those could be, you know, tweener types. They're not, you know, true bigs, especially Mogba. I think he's 6'8".
Right.
But he, again, a very versatile player, and especially a guy like Ware with his athleticism and size. Two names to keep an eye on as we go through the process. When we come back here on Locked On Grizzlies, it's not just for the clicks. It's not just for the views. I promise. Bronny James did some impressive things in his combine debut. Not as impressive as a Mogba or a Ware, but he did you know, make some plays? Is that a guy maybe late in the second round? Memphis calls the bluff of LeBron, who said he always wants to play with his boy. Come on down to Memphis, LeBron. What is that a realistic thing to even talk about? Maybe this is the only time we discuss it, or maybe it's not. We'll talk about that next here on Locked On Grizzlies. But first, DeMichael and I are having a wonderful conversation. We're talking basketball like friends, because that's what we are. We're friends to talk about basketball. This is the kind of analysis you should be looking for from your sports talk, not screaming and yelling like Fox Sports or ESPN. DeMichael and I are just one of the many great examples of this type of sports talk with Locked On Podcast Network. And Locked On Sports Today is your place where you can get this kind of conversation 24/7. It's the first ever 24/7 streaming channel on YouTube for sports. Check it out. DeMichael and I get on there every once in a while. They're covering the NBA playoffs. And then, of course, the major leagues channels like Locked On NBA, Locked On NHL, Locked On MLB. Check out Locked On Sports Today. It's not just on YouTube. You can also check it out on Amazon Fire under the free channels app. Check out Locked On Sports Today now. This episode of Locked On Grizzlies is brought to you by Game Time. I don't know about you, DeMichael, but when I'm trying to get tickets for a last-minute contest, maybe it's the NBA playoffs, NHL playoffs, a Major League Baseball game, maybe it's a pro wrestling event. I've talked about pro wrestling before. Game Time app is the best way to find tickets for whatever kind of event that you're looking for. I love the ability to have flash deals, zone deals. If I'm going to be spur of the moment and I want to take my wife or my kid to any kind of event, Game Time has got your tickets, especially for Major League Baseball. They're easy to find. Every kind of event in and around your area with views from all the seats in the venue and the lowest price guarantee. That's extremely important. Game Time will credit you 110% of the difference. That is a type of deal that you can count on, and it comes to you from Game Time. Take the guesswork out of buying tickets with Game Time. Download the Game Time app, create an account, and use the code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off your first purchase. Again, terms apply. Create an account, redeem the code LOCKEDONNBA for $20 off. Download Game Time today. Last minute tickets, lowest price guaranteed. Make sure you're checking them out. When we come back here on Locked On Grizzlies, again, I promise I'm not fishing for content engagement. Let's talk Bronny James and the Memphis Grizzlies. Stick with us. Welcome back to Locked On Grizzlies. I am Joe Mullinax, noted teller of the truth, Joe Mullinax, and I'm joined by DeMichael Cole, noted Memphis Grizzlies beat writer covering said Grizzlies for the commercial appeal there in Memphis, Tennessee. To Michael, it's been a good episode. Again, tomorrow we'll take a closer look at actually trading the ninth overall pick, what type of deal that could look like. I made some people mad on social media, which I tend to do almost every day. But, you know, Dorian Finney-Smith was a name that I floated. Kelly Olynyk, not for number nine, but you know how I get when I get in my trade moods to Michael. Feels like a good way to handle our Thursday edition of the show. But before we get there, it's still Wednesday, and I felt a little bit wild, partner. So before we started the show, I asked if you would be okay with talking about Bronny James, because LeBron's baby boy, right, his oldest child, if I am I correct in saying that, has decided to go into the NBA draft. He is there at the combine. In fairness to him, you know, kudos to him, not expecting because of his name that he can just show up and not do anything. He's out there working and trying to show that he belongs. He did some good things. I think it was like 4 points, four assists or rebounds. Yeah. You know, he put up decent numbers in his limited minutes that he got. Bronny James has always been unique in the last few years because LeBron has said, he's on record as saying, that whatever NBA team drafted Bronny would be the team that he would finish his NBA career with. Now, I want to stress, this is almost certainly an inside job. Like, the Lakers are probably going to acquire Bronny James in some way, shape, or form. And once you know it, LeBron will sign a two-year deal, and that'll be where he ends his career. I could totally see that happening. But let's just have some fun on this Wednesday and say that's the Memphis Grizzlies that called LeBron's bluff. And they take
the, it's the Bluff City.
They take the 39th pick, and they draft Bronny James. LeBron probably still isn't coming to Memphis. But, again, in this hypothetical, you look at a Bronny James as a kind of combo guard. But when we were discussing this before the show, partner, you brought up a very interesting name that Memphis fans will remember as a possible comp for what Bronny brings to the table.
Yeah. So before I get that, I want to say this. You know, if first you said 39. If they pick him at 39,
they're calling the bluff of LeBron James. That is the only reason why.
Yeah. I mean, you got 2 second round picks. I mean, mm-hmm. if he
get him 57 at 57, would make a lot more sense.
A lot of sense. Now, with that being said, getting back to the comp here, there are a couple guys that come to mind, and even I saw in some of his interviews, he said that Derek White, Drew Holiday, Davion Mitchell are the type of players that he tries to, you know, watch, you know, in terms of impact and winning basketball. And I thought that was fair and realistic of himself. You know, I mean, Drew Holiday is NBA champion, all-league defender, Derek White, all-league defender. And Davion Mitchell, you know, won an NCAA championship as the best perimeter defender in college basketball. So,
because he does not have his dad's size. That is
No. There were, I don't know if you saw it, Joe, but there were football jokes going around when people saw his combine measurements. But with all that being said, you know, 6'1½, I think, without shoes. So you're probably talking 6'3. The wingspan was nice. 6'8 wingspan at that height. It shows to go. He's going to be a terrific defender to have those type of arms. We see the athleticism, 40.5-inch vertical. You know, we saw the chase down blocks, if anything, you saw at USC. But getting back to what you said, you know why I think who comes to mind? For me, it isn't Drew Holiday and Derek White. I tone it down a little bit. De'Anthony Milton.
Ooh, another USC product.
Another USC product. And a lot of people talk about how Bronny James played out of position at USC. And part of that was because Isaiah Collier, who's going to be probably borderline lottery pick, mid-first round pick, and Boogie Ellis, former Memphis Tiger before transferring to USC, were the two guards who got most of the playing time. So he had to play off of those guys or, you know, come in the game, you know, off the bench and whatnot and play off of them. But the point is, he didn't get to really play his natural position, that combo guard spot as much at USC as he did is more of like a 3-4. And in NBA, I think he's more of that De'Anthony Melton, play on the ball a little bit, but more comfortable off the ball. Defensively, he's 6'1", and yes, he's on the shorter end, kind of like Melt was, but he has those long arms that can make up for it. We saw De'Anthony Melton, you know, just affect the game in a lot of ways. I mean, Brevin Knight and Pete Pranica used to call him Mr. Do Something. And I think Bronny James could be a Mr. Do-Something type player. You know, may not, at least not early on his career. He's not going to go out there rookie year 12 points, 5 boards, 5 assists a game. But I think it's realistic, you know, if, you know, because you got to think about all the deficiencies he's dealt with, you know, whether it was the heart condition, whether it was going to a team like USC where he had to play out of position a little bit and whatnot, the late start he got to the season. He kind of was dealt a tough hand. I definitely thought if he went back his second year, he takes a super leap and plays himself into the first round conversation. I don't know what went into the decision, but I think De'Anthony Melton is a solid comp for him right now from a defensive standpoint more than anything. A guy who's going to play the passing lanes, be solid on the ball, defender, knock down some threes here and there, and really affect the game in a lot of different ways. That's his calling card, I think. To be an important and to kind of, you know, hang on in the NBA.
Now, Melton was a second round pick as well in the 30s there.
Early second rounder, right? Yeah.
But an important difference is Melton was an analytics darling, right? People loved Melton from the beginning. That's not necessarily Bronny, right? And for all the reasons that you just outlined, there's logical arguments for it. I want to stress, I'm almost positive that LeBron James is going to be pulling some strings here. He's going to go to the Lakers and say, you take this kid. You find a way to get it done. Or maybe the plan is Bronny's going to fall out of the draft entirely and he can sign wherever he wants. And I wonder where he's going to sign, right? I think there's possibilities for this to end the way that LeBron wants it to end. But it's intriguing for me, partner, because you're going to have at least one two-way deal open, right? And say you change Scottie Pippen Jr., and we've talked about how that doesn't necessarily make sense, but theoretically speaking, with Yuta Watanabe no longer being in the mix, maybe that's something that happened. Now you have two-way contracts. At 57, if he's still on the board, I think there's worse ways to use that two-way deal.
Because you think about it, from a business standpoint, because you're second, your third two-way deal in a normal season. Like the Grizzlies year was just out of whack. Like,
right.
But if you go back the year before that, the guy, the second two-way and the third two-way, they're not playing much. Like they're mop-up mm-hmm. duty. That's the thing about Vince Williams. Like we don't see Vince Williams this season if everything doesn't, you know, happen the way
it did. Right.
But from a finance, I've seen, you know, there were reports that, you know, a lot of teams are interested in possibly taking him in the second round, getting that two-way deal, because you can play him a lot in the G League. And imagine those games in South Haven with the Memphis Hustle. Yeah, yeah. People
are sell out a Memphis teams. Hustle game when the Lakers are in town because LeBron's going to go and watch the night before.
So there's a business standpoint to this where it's the LeBron James factor that you've, you know, touched on, but it's also the business standpoint of that's LeBron's son. Adding him, it might be financially worth it.
No, absolutely. You're exactly right. So let us know in the comments if you think we're crazy. Again, I want to stress, this is a hypothetical. I don't think, DeMichael, I don't want to speak for your partner. You don't assume the Grizzlies would go in this direction. Right. And I don't think they would either necessarily. But again, there's worse ways to use the number 57 overall pick if they keep it. How do you feel about Bronny James? Maybe, hypothetically speaking, being a Memphis Grizzly, let us know in the comments. On tomorrow's show, partner, again, there were other reports coming out of the combine, Memphis perhaps being interested in shopping the number 9 pick. They expect to be contenders. This is music to my ears, and I'm pretty sure it's music to yours as well.
This
is what we've wanted to hear them say. I do think they'll explore all options, but the Grizzlies, are they trying to win a championship or not? Maybe on Thursday's episode, we explore some ways they can try to get to that ends through the means of the number 9 pick.
I'm all for it. I mean, this is going to be the Joe Mullenix led podcast. You come bring all the ideas, and I know you're going to look into it. You're going to go to your trade machine, tell us what works, what doesn't work. I'm looking forward to it. I'm just here to give my opinion on whatever deals that you come up with. But all that aside, it makes a lot of sense for the Grizzlies to definitely do everything in their power to exhaust all options with this number 9 pick. We touched on it 1,000 times. This isn't, you know, the strongest draft in the world, but there are also some players who I think personally can marginally make the team better. Mm-hmm. But there are other ways you can use that 9 pick to make the team substantially better. I think use that 9 pick and package it in other ways. And we should definitely look into some of those ideas, as especially with the Grizzlies. You know, with the tax situation, they're going to be a luxury tax team, potentially first apron, and maybe even beyond that, depending on how this offseason plays out. All of it is worth exploring, but it starts with that number 9 pick.
Are you trying to win a championship or not? On our Thursday edition of the show, we are going to try to win a championship by getting a veteran instead of a rookie with that number 9 overall pick. I'm looking forward to it. It's going to be great. Make sure you're with us. Make sure you're liking, commenting, rating, reviewing, subscribing, wherever you get your podcasts, Apple, Amazon, Spotify, YouTube, of course. Again, shout out to everybody checking us out on YouTube. We've had a great couple of days over on YouTube. DeMichael and I appreciate it ever so much. Give us feedback. Let us know how you're thinking and feeling about the show, about what we're talking about on the show. We've taken ideas from the comments in the past and talked about them on the program. And of course, smash that subscribe button and make us a part of your each and every day NBA and Memphis Grizzlies content consumption whenever an episode drops. Make sure you're checking out Locked On Sports Today on YouTube and Amazon Fire and the free channels portion of the app. Make sure that you're checking out Locked On NBA and all the other great podcasts that are part of the Locked On Podcast Network. But again, make sure Locked On Grizzlies is your first listen, your first watch each and every time an episode drops. For DeMichael, I'm Joe. Stay locked in. Have a great rest of your Wednesday. We appreciate you, and we'll catch you back here next time on Locked On Grizzlies. See ya.